Hey there, welcome to another review, this time of the 1984 drama, Firstborn. Now, Firstborn is, in a lot of ways, an 80s teen drama, and there are a few of them. I guess you can consider certain films like The Karate Kid and other movies as teen dramas, but I don't know. I mean, this is definitely a little bit more serious in the type of subject material that it's dealing with. So I kind of lean towards this as a better example of a teen drama versus something like 16 Candles or any of these John Hughes films. Maybe something like She's Having a Baby might be something. But then again, I don't know. I haven't seen that, so I can't really say anything about it. But maybe that might be the closest to being somewhat, realistic in its approach to dramatic real-life events and things that happen in people's lives, like this movie. Now, of course, I would be lying to you if I didn't discover this movie because it had Peter Weller in the cast. Because I had no idea about this movie, or even if it even existed until, like, a few years ago, when I heard of it, and I think I saw it on VHS, because I was like, Peter Weller? I love Peter Weller, he's one of my favorite actors, so I was like, awesome. And I was also curious about it because of Christopher Collet, because I liked him in The Manhattan Project with John Lithgow. And so I got it on VHS, really liked what I saw. I thought it was actually a really good movie. And then I just kept waiting for it to come out on DVD. And then eventually all of Films did release it. In, I think, like 2012 or something. So it released it a while back. Now the Blu-ray is apparently out of print, and this DVD might be kind of hard to find nowadays. But regardless, I did find it did get an official release, which is nice to see. Because this is the best the film has ever looked, and it was really nice to see it. In widescreen instead of full screen, and before this, the best it looked was on a Laserdisc. And, that wasn't too bad. It was definitely watchable. But anyway, this is, in my opinion, one of, if not the best 80s teen drama that I have seen. And I know that's high praise, but I mean it. Because watching this again just really solidifies my love for this film. I also think this is incredibly underrated and overlooked. Now, I know there's a lot of critics who bash the film or give it middling reviews, or they say things like, oh, well, it was good for the first hour or so, but then it fell apart near the end. But I've never read a single review of this film where they've explained why it fell apart. They just said it fell apart. And to me personally, having seen the film numerous times, I don't see how this could end any better than it does. And I'll talk about that more in depth later. Now, Firstborn is a 1984 film. It is directed by Michael Apted, and it was released on October 26th of 1984, around the same time as The Terminator. So it was effectively terminated at the box office. It made I guess you could say it made a little bit of a profit. It made $6 million at the box office, but I don't know what its budget was. So unless the budget was like $2 million or $1 million, then it didn't make a lot of money, if any sort of profit. But I guess it definitely did make enough of an impact on people to get a DVD release. It also marks the feature film debut for actor Corey Haim. And he does make a great first impression in this. You could see why so many people saw a lot of potential in this young actor, in Corey Haim. He's got charisma, he's got spunk, he's a good kid actor, he can deliver his lines well, he's likable. And that would carry over into his later films in his career. Although, I have to admit, I think he was a better actor as a kid than he was as an adult, for at least from what I've seen. And I definitely do miss him, and may he rest in peace. Michael Apted, he's a pretty underrated director, too. I mean, he's directed a lot of really great classic films, in my opinion. not just Firstborn. I mean, he directed Gorillas in the Mist, which I really like, which is another underrated film with Sigourney Weaver. He directed Class Action, a really great judicial thriller with Gene Hackman and Mary Elizabeth Mastrantonio. He directed Extreme Measures with Hugh Grant and Gene Hackman, which is another really underrated film. He's had a few bombs here and there, but for the most part, he's a pretty consistent director. This film definitely did benefit from his presence. The film was written by Ron Coslow, and I really do think this is a really solid screenplay. This is a script that I think does a great job writing these characters. This is a film that hinges upon its characters. It's a pretty small film. It's pretty straightforward. It doesn't have a lot of twists and turns. And so it relies a lot upon how well written its characters are, and how well rounded they are, and how charismatic they are. And it does a great job with that, with all of those things. I love how the protagonists and the antagonists are not perfect. The antagonist in this case is Peter Weller's character, Sam. He's not perfect, but he's not 100% evil either. Like, he's a bad guy and he's an asshole, but he's misguided. He's an extremely misguided person who maybe if he took some different paths in his life, might not be as much of an asshole. And I like that a lot about this film. That's one of the many things that I really like about this movie is how well the written the characters are. They feel human. They don't feel like they're just written for a movie. These feel like real characters. Even when they might be saying some corny lines of dialogue, they're still so well written and well performed by the actors and the actresses that, they feel like real people. This feels like a slice of life. And it does feel like it's a picture, a portrait, a moving picture, so to speak, of a family that's deteriorating before your very eyes. And because of this intruder that's come into their family dynamic. It also features a really rollicking, rocking score by Michael Small. This is a score I would love to get my hands on, but apparently it's out of print. There's a really great main theme that this film has that you could kind of use it as a theme for Christopher Collet's character. And it's badass. It's epic. It's this really memorable, awesome, rocking guitar solo. And this is the type of music you don't hear a lot nowadays anymore in films. And I miss this type of music. There are people who see this film and say, oh, that's corny or that's cheesy. Well, to me, it's awesome and it adds to the film's charm. And I don't find it to be a problem at all whatsoever. I think the score is great. And the soundtrack choices are really good too. I mean, you have Runner by the Manfred Mann Band. And that's a really underrated song that I don't think enough people talk about. And then you have essentially what is the main track from the soundtrack, No Guarantees by the Nobodies. Now, this is a song that opens up the film in the opening credits, and it's a really underrated rock pop song that has a great tune. It's well written for the most part, it's catchy. It's memorable, but it's by a band called the Nobodies that nobody seems to remember. So it's kind of ironic. They call their band the Nobodies, and then after all these years, for the most part, nobody really remembers who they were or whether or not they even existed to begin with. But I will always remember this band pretty fondly for the song that they did for their debut album, No Guarantees. Which is, I think it's one of their debut album. I could be wrong. It could have been like one of their later albums, but this song was featured prominently in this film, and ever since I heard it, I automatically fell in love with it. I think it's a great song, and I really do recommend you give it a listen sometime. Now, and also this film also features cinematography by Ralph D. Bode. It's edited by Arthur Schmidt. And it has a running time of about 103 minutes. Now, for the most part, That goes by really quickly. I'm not really bored by this film. Now, I could see why some people might be, because there isn't like a lot of action in this, although there is a great chase scene near the end. But it's not that type of film. It's a drama. It's a family drama. It's not really an action film. It's not a thriller either. It's a drama. It's a straight up drama. So if you know that going in, I think you might be able to enjoy it and maybe at least appreciate it for what it is. Now, it features a pretty small cast that's comprised of Teri Garr as Wendy Livingston, Peter Weller as Sam, and Peter Weller just delivers a powerhouse performance in this that is just unforgettable, at least for me personally. This performance in this movie, just like all his other performances that he's ever done, at least the ones that I've seen, just further cement his legacy as an actor and show you how great he is. It shows you how multifaceted, how talented of an actor Peter Weller is, because he can play a great good guy in things in movies like RoboCop and 50-50, and he can also play a great bad guy, a great antagonist, like his performance in this film as Sam. He's very intimidating in this. He plays a character you do not want to get on his bad side, and it's a great performance. He just smolders. It's a smoldering powerhouse, just powder keg of a performance that is just honestly one of his best performances of his career, and definitely one of his most overlooked. Christopher Collet is also really great in this. He's likable. He's charismatic. This is probably the best performance of Christopher Collet's career as well. And I liked him in films like The Manhattan Project. But, this really does give him a lot to work with. And he does a really good job of what he has here. He plays Jake Livingston, who is the firstborn. He was essentially the main character of the film. Although there are other characters in the movie as well. I mean, Corey Haim plays his younger brother Brian in, like I was saying, his acting debut. Sarah Jessica Parker has a bit early bit role here as Lisa, Jake's girlfriend. She's fun. And you have Robert Downey Jr. has a really early role as Lee, one of Christopher Collette's character's friends. And you could see how talented and how unique Robert Downey Jr. was. Even in his like little brief scenes in this, you could definitely see a star in the making, because every scene that he was in, and there were only like a few scenes, he lit up the screen. He was just so charismatic, and you just wanted to see more of him. He walks on in into the house, and he just goes in and says, "Where are the cookies? The cookies! Give me the cookies!" And for anyone else, that would just be a throwaway line, a throwaway scene. Nobody would remember it. But it's Robert Downey Jr., and he just goes in all in with it. And it's just so charismatic and witty with the way that he delivers the line that you just want to see more of him and you want to hang out with the guy. So, I could say Christopher Collette's character, Jake was lucky to be friends with Robert Downey Jr. Now, the movie, it like I said, it has a very straightforward plot. It deals with 16-year-old Jake Livingston, the firstborn, played by Christopher Collette. He's always been the man of the Livingston home since his parents divorced, until his mother, played by Teri Garr, who also delivers one of the best performances of her career as well. Here it shows her acting chops. She can be the bubbly personality that she's known for in a lot of her films, but she can also play a character who's downtrodden, who's dealing with emotions, who's really kind of struggling to find her place in life, and is also sadly being manipulated. And so it was a difficult role to nail, and she did it. She really did nail it. This role of a mother who is reeling after a divorce, and she's trying to find a bounce back guy, and she ends up unfortunately finding the wrong guy for the rebound. And at first, it seems like things are good and things are okay and things are going to end out fine between the two. And there's probably a mutual attraction between Sam and Wendy. But then things go awry when Sam, he just, like I said, he gets misguided. He gets these grand ideas in his head about starting a business and getting money to start a restaurant. And they don't really have the income. They don't have the capital for that. And so he convinces Wendy to do things like buy some cocaine, and then Sam will sell it, and they can raise the money to be able to pay for the restaurant. And in Sam's mind, he's doing the right thing. He's helping the family. They're going to have a restaurant. We're going to move into bigger, brighter, better things. But, when it comes to Wendy, and not really necessarily Wendy, but of course her sons, they're like, this isn't right. This isn't how the family, this is not how our family should be. And, but she's so manipulated, she's so caught in Sam's web that she just doesn't know how to get out. And so it's up to her sons and her eldest son, played by Christopher Collet, to find a way to save the family before it crumbles, before it falls completely apart. So, and that's mainly what the plot is. She starts seeing Sam, and who's an alcoholic and a drug addict, and it forces Jake's mother, Wendy, played by Teri Garr, into a more self-destructive lifestyle. And the film handles it rather subtly, but rather effectively. I mean, there's one scene where Christopher Collet, Jake, he's having a hard time sleeping, and so because Sam likes to have these wild parties at the house that go on to all ends and all hours of the night. And he walks down the stairs from his bedroom and looks down below. And he sees all the craziness, and his mom is there by Sam's side, and she's dressed in the nines, and everybody's looks like they're having a good time. But then he sees Peter, what he focuses in on Sam. And Sam has a line of cocaine on the top of this pinball machine that he's bought. And then this is one of many things that he's bought that kind of shows you, like, where's this money coming from and what's going on here? Because things start to get a bit more lavish, and things get a little bit out of hand, and you're wondering, okay, where's this pinball machine come from that's in the living room? And then you see Sam snorting lines of cocaine off the top of the pinball machine. And of course, Jake is he's looking down and he's like, this is fucked up. And then Sam and Jake lock eyes. And Peter Weller doesn't even have to say a word. He displays every emotion that you could possibly ask for in this scene. He looks up at Jake and it's that kind of look of, you shouldn't see this. You shouldn't be seeing this. And he tries to, like, cover up the cocaine. And then Jake goes and walks up the stairs. So that's the kind of subtle things I'm talking about. I mean, you might think it's not that subtle, but I'm saying it's like one, it's just like one little thing. There isn't multiple scenes of Sam snorting cocaine, and he doesn't snort a mountain of cocaine like he's Tony Montana from Scarface. It's just like three little lines, snorts of one or two, and then he sees the kid, and then is all like, you shouldn't be looking at this. Go back upstairs. And if it's just a little bit of drugs, a little bit of fun, okay, maybe it's not that bad of a deal. But things get out of hand. And it starts affecting Wendy, and it seems like she's taking the drugs too, but you don't see her take the drugs, but she's definitely changing the way that she behaves and acts around her kids. She's becoming a really bad parent. And she's also becoming a really bad housekeeper. Because the house is just getting filthier and filthier as the days go by, which is a great way to represent the deterioration of the family, of the destruction of the family by Sam and his presence. And there's a great way to visually showcase that, that could easily be overlooked by a lot of people who see this film because it's just in the background. And so Wendy, she can't see beyond Sam's charms because he's eminently charming. It's Peter Weller we're talking about. Because even early in the film, before he got these grand ideas and forgive my phone. That's my phone. My phone's excited. It's sending me a text message or something. I'm not stopping this video for that. I'm on a roll. But anyway, so she's having a good, you know, Peter Weller at first, his character, oh my God, cell phone, would you fucking quit it with the fucking bullshit? I know what my, all right, I'm turning it off. Fucking ridiculous. I apologize. My phone's too excited. My phone's like, Firstborn, I like that movie too! So Peter Weller at first, he seems like this really nice guy. He's kind of, you know, there's an awkward sort of first meeting between him and Jake, but it seems like he kind of hits it off with Jake. You know, he buys him a motorcycle. They have some fun with a barbecue. You know, it seems like, oh, you know, maybe he's a little bit rough around the edges, but maybe he means well. And, you know, maybe he has some problems, but he wants to work through them and try to be a better guy. I mean, you know, hey, and I'm all for, you know, success stories and for giving people second chances. And at first it seems like that, and that's probably why Wendy fell in love with him. That's what makes this so great in a lot of ways, is because this happens all the time in real life with a lot of families. The mom falls for this guy who isn't really necessarily the best type, best person, and isn't really a good guy, but she falls for him because of his charm, and then she has her own emotional needs as well, that she feels that they need to be met, and he fulfills those needs for her, and so it builds this bond that isn't necessarily built around love, it's built around dependency upon one another. There's even a line of dialogue where Peter Weller's character says, your mom needs me, you know, she needs me, or actually I think Wendy says, he needs me, and when she's talking about Sam. So that's very real. And so his younger brother Brian, Jake's younger brother Brian, Corey Haim, he ends up, you know, he can't deal with Sam's, his mannerisms and the way he goes about things. And so it ends up really hurting his relationship with his brother and with his mother, and it causes issues at his school. He starts getting in fights at school. Jake himself, he thinks Sam's a flake, he thinks he's a bullshitter, he thinks he's full of shit, and so he just starts to resent Sam being in the house. And at first it seems like maybe these are just feelings and maybe they'll go away, but then Sam begins to really put down the ground rules and he starts disciplining the boys, expects them to obey them at all costs, and then it becomes kind of abusive. Jake then becomes aware of a drug deal that Sam is involved in, and he steals the drugs and then he hides them. And then Sam verbally, then violently, begins demanding that they be returned. And this is then where, this is when the light bulb goes off in Wendy's head, when she realizes what kind of man, what kind of human being, what kind of person she's brought into their son, into her son's lives. And even before this scene, there was fire starting to burn. And a good example of that is this great scene that just shows you how intimidating and how great Peter Weller is as an actor. Jake is he's working out with his weight set, and he's trying to be talk tough and trying to be a badass about things. And Peter Weller's telling him about, you know, things about that, saying, I love your mother and things like that. We're going to get that restaurant. We're going to get these things. And, you know, then Jake, he says this flippant remark to Peter Weller, to Sam. He's like, next time you come in my room, knock. And then Sam just grabs the bar, holds it, stares death daggers into Jake's face, and in typical Peter Weller fashion, delivers the line like only Peter Weller can deliver it. Next time you pass judgment on me, don't go whining to your mother like some chicken shit wimp. Have the balls to come say it to my face. And it was just a very, it was like a really tense moment. And then before Sam even hides the drugs, there's a really great crowd-pleasing moment where Sam ends up, he's had it up to here with, he's dealing with all this stress with his mom, with his family, and, with Sam. And now his asshole teacher at his high school class is being the asshole that he is. And eventually he just can't take it anymore. And he calls it like it is, calls the teacher an asshole, because he's pissed off now because the teacher gave him an F on his paper and says, "You plagiarized it." And, and Jake is like, "Hey, I didn't plagiarize this. I referenced things. And, I'm gonna go, this is bullshit." And the teacher's all like, "After class." And Jake's like, "No, I'll go over to the library right now, and I'll go in, and I'll go and get that book, and I'll show it to you, and I'll prove to you right now that I didn't plagiarize." And the teacher's still like, "After class." And it just infuriated him. And the reason why is because this guy is an asshole. The actor who played this guy did a great job playing an asshole. He's the type of guy you want to punch square in the face. I mean, there was an earlier scene where one of the students in the class was getting up in front of the class and doing a speech, and he was talking about what he thought was an important, a person who had an impact on American history, and he was talking about Rocky Balboa. And in a lot of ways, there is a legitimate argument there that Rocky kind of did make a considerable impact in American history. And well, the teacher is all like, "Boring." And he just cuts him off and then basically says, "Rocky is a fictional character," and basically just shits on the poor kid. And then later in the film, he's just continuing to be, he has like a surprise quiz for people based on an assignment that he said that wasn't necessary. Which is just a dick move on a teacher's part. He's the type of teacher that's just miserable and he's taking it out on his students. And anybody who's been to high school can really sympathize with the students and could definitely be cheering the film on and definitely cheering Jake on when he stands up and he talks this guy down and he tells him what's what. I mean, it is a very crowd-pleasing moment. Because he's like, "You don't want the class to know. You want to be the only one with the answer. You want us to think you're the coolest, hippest. If you're that great, why are you trying so hard to impress us? You keep telling us about the real world. But in the real world, you'd be a grown man competing with a bunch of 10th graders." And then he throws his paper in the teacher's face. And then he says, "You're a lightweight." And then he storms out of that classroom, and then he's walking down the hallway with this really awesome rad metal like riff soundtrack. And then that's when he gets on his bike and then comes up with the plan to kick Sam out of his house. And he hides the drugs. Sam finds out, basically beats it out of him to be able to, tell him where the drugs are. Leads to a chase because that's what happens, really. He tries to beat it out of him, but then because Sam is actually pretty clever, not Sam, I mean Jake. Jake is actually pretty clever here, Christopher Collet. He decides to get on a little chase with Sam. And this is a really well done chase scene. Exciting. And apparently it was edited a bunch of times because sadly, the stuntman, who you can definitely see him right up in front and center in this scene. There are multiple scenes in this particular chase between Christopher Collette's character Jake on a motorbike and Sam in a Jeep or an SUV that's chasing after him, or truck. I think it's like a Jeep truck combo thing. And you can clearly tell that it's not Christopher Collet. The guy has shorter hair, he's taller. But this stuntman, Bill Anagos, who's doubling for Chris Collet, he was actually struck by the train that was around the transit tracks where they were shooting the film in Morristown, New Jersey, shooting this particular sequence. It was overtaken by an NGT commuter train, and Bill actually got hit by the train. He was knocked off the right of way, and he suffered a broken leg. And then there was heavy editing with the previous takes. The accident was not shown, and the film progressed from there. But in good, you know, there's a good side to that story, though, because Bill ended up recovering. He made a full recovery, and he recovered well enough to be able to go back to his stunt job and do stunt work for other films. So he was fine, and thank God he was, because that could have been a lot worse. I mean, being struck by a train, I mean, that could have been deadly. So, thankfully he was okay. And that scene, I can't really tell where the edits are. That's how well put together that edit and that chase scene is. And how often in a film like this do you have a chase scene? So that was really fun. That was a great, really well put together chase scene, great score. And what I mean by Jake's pretty clever is because, okay, he leads Sam on this chase, and then he ends up going back to his house, and he tries to lock Sam out. I mean, it's a great idea, but Sam is smarter, and he breaks through the basement window, and it doesn't end up doing shit. And then, you know, Sam gets in the house and starts just, he's lost it now. Maybe he meant well. See, that's the thing that I like. Like I said, that's another thing I really like about the film is that how Sam, the antagonist, isn't black and white evil. He's not like, oh, he's just evil and that's it. He's just a bad guy. No, there's a little bit more to it. Maybe he's meant well. Maybe he does love Wendy. Maybe he loves her a lot. And maybe he had good intentions. You know, like the saying goes, the path to hell or the road to hell is paved with good intentions. So maybe that's how it was. He had good intentions from the start. He got overzealous, overconfident. His ego got in the way for what, or he just, or drugs. He got too much drugs. He became addicted. There was alcohol or cocaine, whatever it was, it affected his judgment. And it influenced the rest of the family in a negative way. And then when Teri Garr finally gets the balls to say, no, you're gone, get out of my house, because Sam starts attacking Christopher Collette, starts throwing him around. He even throws Corey Haim around. He starts throwing Corey Haim around the house. And finally she's like, no, get out of here. And he's like, no, I'm not leaving. And that happens a lot in these type of instances in real life, where it's like, no, I'm not going anywhere. I'm too comfortable. I don't see any reason why I have to go. I'm doing the right thing here. What's wrong? Why? You know, your kids are chicken shits. Your kids are shitheads. Not me. And so it's this kind of thing where they become attached to the family. They become attached to the mother. And they don't want to leave. This happens a lot. That's how a lot of domestic disturbances happen, is stuff like this. They realize they're going to lose something that they don't want to lose, and they fight back in violent and sometimes deadly ways because they don't want to lose it. And that's what happens. Sam starts cleaning house. He's pissed. He's pissed off, even though he's got the drugs back. It doesn't matter. It's about once Wendy says no, get out of my house, that just sends him off the rails. Whatever element of you know of a brain, not really necessarily a brain, but whatever element of truthfulness or true love that he had for Wendy or care that he had for the family just goes out the window there because it becomes defense. It becomes self-defense. I don't want to lose this free ride. I don't want to go back to living on the street. I don't want to go back to doing this. I don't want to do that. and you can't make me. And I'm going to make you stay with me because this is my house now. This is my family now. You are my wife. And it's, that's the kind of thing. It's like, and, but the film actually ends in a pretty crowd-pleasing way, in a way that I honestly do not see in a lot of films like this, where Jake stands up. Jake stands up for his family and for himself, and he beats the shit out of Peter Weller. He kicks Sam in the balls. There's a really memorable, really, like, cheering moment, you know, a moment that makes you want to clap and stand up and cheer, where Christopher Collet, after he's kicked him in the balls, he gets up and he gets ready to just hit him with a haymaker, and he flips up his jacket really quick, his hoodie, you know, like he goes like this, and he's like, he's ready, and then boom, just lays one right on Peter Weller's chin, knocks him on the ground, he starts pummeling him and beating him up. And this isn't necessarily unrealistic to me, because he's 16 years old, and this character, he plays lacrosse, so he's in good shape. He's in good physical shape. And it's not like it's Corey Haim's character beating up on Peter Weller. He tries to do that. Corey Haim's character goes in, Brian grabs a baseball bat, starts hitting Peter Weller's character with it. But Peter Weller throws the kid around the room, grabs the baseball bat, and starts hitting Christopher Collet with it. And you think, oh, this is it. Or, you know, he grabs a baseball bat, he's going to knock Christopher Collet out, but then Christopher Collet hits him in the balls and then knocks him out on the knocks him out with a sucker punch. And then he gets him on the ground, starts punching him, and basically tells him, get out. And he leaves. Peter Weller's character Sam gets up, grabs his bags, walks out the front door, gets in his truck, and drives away. On his own accord. He doesn't get arrested by the cops. None of that happens. He doesn't die. So I don't, that's what I'm talking about when the critics are like, fell apart at the end. What ending were you expecting? What do you think this is building up to? This is building up to Jake standing up for his family and saving it from destruction. That's what it was. That's what it was building up for. What do you think it was going to do? Was it just going to get arrested? Oh, Peter Weller's character was going to win? If that happened, if Sam won, basically forced his will upon this poor family, and the movie ended like that, I would have been like, fuck this movie. This movie can go fuck itself, because what kind of fucking ending is that? But it didn't go there. So I don't get it. I don't understand the criticism. Oh, the ending isn't good. Why? I think it's a great ending. The family is broken. It's got scars that will probably never heal. It's going to take a while for the family to even allow another man into the, you know, into the family dynamic, because of the scars and the mental anguish and the physical scars that have been caused by this relationship with Sam. And it's not over, technically. I mean, there's definitely going to be the moment where he's going to come back and beg his baby to come back to him. And, you know, and sometimes in those scenarios, the crazy thing happens. They get back together. So, I mean, that's not going to, hopefully not going to happen in this family. And I don't see that happening. But, I mean, there are more steps to happen after this. Just because they kicked him out and he left doesn't mean he's gone. I mean, that's the thing with a relationship like this, an abusive relationship like this, it doesn't mean he's gone. He could come back. And he could come back and wreak havoc in a whole nother way, because that happens sometimes, where somebody gets kicked out, and they come back, and they're loaded for fucking bear. And they go in, and they commit horrible, heinous crimes. I mean, I've seen cases on Unsolved Mysteries like this, or America's Most Wanted, where some jilted lover gets kicked out of his girlfriend's house, and he comes back, and like the sick fuck that he is, grabs a gun and shoots the mother and shoots the kid, and then walks and just heads off. It happens. Thankfully, that a lot of those motherfuckers got caught though, which is good. But yeah, so it could have gone that route, but it didn't do that. Thankfully, so if it did that route, I'd be like, fuck this movie. But no, it goes the route of Christopher Collet. Technically the main character in the film, kicks Peter Weller's ass. He deserved the ass kicking. Peter Weller leaves, and then the family is left to pick up the pieces the best way that they can. And that's Firstborn. Now, the film, honestly, I think it could have used a better title. Firstborn isn't really a great title. It makes you think of babies and other stuff. And I like the biblical verse, the biblical, you know, the part in the Bible where it's like, oh, sacrifice your firstborn son. But, and honestly, the original title, Moving In, is actually a lot better. It fits the film better. And Firstborn is just like one of those, like, what? So the film might have been a hard sell because of the title, because people are like, what is up with this title? Or is this a hard sell to begin with because it's never really going to be a hit? It's never going to be a huge box office success. And that's fine. But I'm glad it was, I'm thrilled that it was made still, because it's a really well-made film. It's a really well-put-together film. It's a simple, straightforward story, family dynamic, a family that's falling apart because of this outside interference that's come in and has really changed the dynamic for the worse. And it shows the effect this negative influence has upon the entire family, on the mother, on the children. And it also shows that you can fight back and that you can end this. And you can find a way to end this nightmare. Because in a lot of ways, this is a horror that's more horrifying than Freddy Krueger or Jason Voorhees. The horror of family dynamic, the horror of the family being torn apart at the seams. That is horrifying, especially for anyone who is a part of a family, a close, tight-knit family. This, to see that family being torn apart at the seams, that's horrifying. That's a living nightmare, even more so than the scariest horror film you can think of. So, this film does a great job portraying that, showcasing that in an unflinching way that it doesn't pull any punches. You would not see this movie today. This movie got a PG-13 rating, and I can't believe that because it has drug use and it has scenes of kids getting abused and a mother getting bitch slapped by Peter Weller's character Sam multiple times. This has got child abuse, wife abuse, you know, not really wife abuse, but, you know, girlfriend abuse. I mean, it's got a lot of abuse in it, and this is not the kind of film that I think would be made nowadays and released in theaters. You could have a Lifetime original movie. I don't watch those movies, so I can't really say anything about those in terms of their comparison with this film, but, you know, people say it's like a Lifetime film. I don't get it, because I don't watch Lifetime movies, but whatever. Regardless, Lifetime films probably don't have the same budget that this one does, and they sure as hell don't have Peter Weller, and they also probably don't take things nearly as seriously as this does. They go a melodramatic route that is just laughable, that it doesn't have any real impact. This film has an impact. This is a film that sticks with me, that stays with me, that has that real, genuine impact that you want out of a film like this, out of a film from this particular genre. So, I know I've talked your ear off about this film. I'm like the only one who's ever done a review of this movie that's over 40-something minutes, but I really like this film. When it comes to talking about movies I really enjoy and I really love, I kind of want to give as in-depth of a review as I possibly can give the film. Now, I don't know what else to say about the film except it was rated at 5 stars, and I give it 5 out of 5. I honestly don't find anything wrong with this film. It exceeds my expectations for it, and it excels at what it's trying to do, at being an 80s teen drama. And, you know, it even has some extra stuff too, like the chase scene. So, yeah, thank you for watching my review of Firstborn, and check it out sometime. If you can find it, give it a look. There are some websites you can be able to watch it streaming on. You can rent it. I would probably prefer, if you can, to buy it legally because that way you're supporting the people who made the film. But if you can't, maybe find some other way to watch it, because I definitely do think it's worth a watch. I think it's a film that people should watch at least once. It might not be for everybody. It's not a film you watch all the time. It's not a film that's going to be feel good. It's not a film that's, going to really necessarily put a smile on your face at the end. But it does have some genuinely humorous moments in it, though, that break the levity. That not necessarily break the levity, but bring some levity to the film, to the serious, dour circumstances. But yeah, I think it's a winner. I really do. So thank you for watching, and I will see you guys later. See ya.